Hello and welcome to the Pretentious Show. I'm Alexander Devenport. I was doing a group exhibition for a final exam in university quite a while ago when an odd thing happened. Our mentor took down two pictures of a fantasy landscape and replaced it with another work of art of that particular student. Now, I don't have a problem with him helping out the student. After all, he was the one that was showing her what to do and he was actually marking her in the end. However, I have a problem with his judgment. It's as if he was saying, this isn't art, this is illustration, let's replace it. Now, I realize that's not what he was thinking, but my question is, while we have the power to call a men's urinal art, do we have the power to call a painting not art? How the hell do we define and judge this subject? I personally loathe this question because it's very subjective, and I get a headache when I just hear arguments over it. There are better things to talk about than the dictionary's definition of art. So, naturally, someone thought it was a great idea to create a three-week program dedicated to defining and judging young artists' work. So grab your nearest alcoholic beverage, because I'm pulling you into my own personal hell. This is the School of Saatchi. The School of Saatchi was a three-week episode documentary with a killer theme tune. Six young artists try to woo art critics and eventually get the top prize, an exhibition in Salzburg, and a scholarship with Charles Saatchi, the most influential art dealer and collector in the entire world. One touch of his almighty golden finger can turn any artist into a celebrity. He is responsible for the art show Sensation, the exhibition accidentally responsible for the canonization of contemporary art in the world and putting Britain's modern art world on the map. And artists like Jeff Koons, Damien Hirst, and Tracy Emin became art celebrities. Hey, there's Tracy Emin now. She's one of the judges. The other judges are Frank Cohen, a famous art collector, also known as the Saatchi of the North, Kate Bush, a well-established art curator, and finally, Mathew Collings. Hang on. Where is he? Oh wait, that's not him, is it?
Saatchi is a sort of kingmaker and enjoys that process.
Oh, Mathew, what have they done to you? Oh yeah, I keep forgetting. This Is Modern Art was made 10 years ago. Wait a minute. 10 years ago? Of course. Now's our chance to find out what he's really thinking. You know, find out what's going on in the art world today. And,
the potential for change.
That's it. Change. And in this post-millennium economic struggle, I look forward to finding out what the experts have to say.
I specialise in endurance performance art, and the piece I bought here today is called Copy of War and Peace.
I think I'd find this work too much the work of a madman rather than art exactly.
Okay.
The chemical which started the Big Bang is the chemical responsible for love in the human mind. I will now expose them to shortwave transmissions.
You'll see. Oh, very good.
I think you're nice, but you're just too weird.
Yeah.
What the work is it's an email to Martin Creed and the response that I got. Well, look, the whole point of this work is about connecting with an artist. So I took the question and I took the response and screwed them up, and that was the work.
I'm not sure where that's going to go, and I've got to say no, I'm afraid.
Okay.
Well, my work is an attempt at filtering imagery and experience through this process of human experience.
This is the biggest load of bullshit I've ever heard in my life. You're not convincing me, you are winging it, and you've done it really badly. Sorry.
All right, stop there. Stop there. I'm sorry. That's the line for me. Tracy Emin, the artist known for putting a bed in a gallery, is calling this work of art bullshit. And you know what I really hate? I agree with her. The artist obviously had nothing to show. He just grabbed a bunch of chairs from the waiting area and just put them in a circle as a form of last-minute found object sculpture, and then, as Tracy puts it, wings it by talking about human experience. No, no, no. Don't try and bullshit your way out of this by talking about human experience. If you're going to do a last-minute found object sort of thing, you might as well be relevant towards the concept and the environment. Don't try and brush off the fact that you just found those chairs on the floor. Use that scenario. I'm not questioning whether this is art or not. I'm just questioning your lack of effort. But you know what angers me more than anything? Really? It's myself. I anger myself. Why? Because as a television viewer, I'm sitting here watching Tracy Emin and saying that she doesn't deserve to have the same opinion of me because of her previous work. That's what happens when you take art world and put it in this lifestyle reality television drama. You see, already, I hate a complete stranger for being too lazy, Tracy Emin for being too contradictory, and myself for being a judgmental prick. Jesus Christ! It's only 30 minutes into this bloody show, and already I'm loathing the existence of reality. Seriously, though, I do love Tracy Emin's work. It speaks from the heart, and you get a good feeling for the pain that this woman is carrying. So with a lot of emotional attachment she has to her work, I can understand when she pisses over someone else's for winning it. Now that I've talked my way through that issue, I guess it's a good time to bring up the inevitable question that really makes my ears bleed. This is, what makes something a work of art? Michel Duchamp says, anything as long as the artist says it is. Sol LeWitt says, it's a concept. Andy Warhol says, anything I can get away with. And a mate in the pub said, a concept and an aesthetic. You know what? I'm going to get some legal advice.
Grabbers and grabbers.
Hello, I'd like a definition of fine art pronto.
A definition of good art?
No, actually fine.
Sounds tricky. But not for corporate man.
Corporate man, does whatever corporate can. Crushes bullshit like a flea, justice is his morning tea. Look out, here comes corporate man.
To the art gallery. At corporate HQ, nothing creates quite as much disagreement as taste in art. One person likes Jane Austen, another likes Mills and Boone. The only thing they can agree on is that the other person has no taste. But as art lovers or artists, we should be able to appreciate forms of art other than simply by what we personally like. That's why I developed my simple three-step test for evaluating art. How does it work? Let's see some art, shall we?
Step one of my test sounds simple. Setting all judgment aside, what reaction do you have to the work? What is your response? This can be deceptively tricky. It's always tempting to let your own prejudices affect your judgment. That is why I like to consider this question before I've thought about the work more critically, and especially before I know the name of the artist. Do I respond to the work? Do I care about it at all? If so, then the artist has done well. Even if I hate the artwork, the mere fact that I have had a reaction is better than nothing. But, of course, the test doesn't stop there. I don't like Twilight, but then, I'm not a 14-year-old girl. Much as I may dislike this movie, I can understand why it would move a generation of teenage girls. So despite what I may think, I have to put my preferences in my pocket and accept that there's quite a lot of value in what I would otherwise call an awful film. Sometimes art pieces are interesting not because they're effective, but because they're hard to make. Fruit in a bowl. Means nothing to me. Don't see why it would mean something to anyone, really. But technically impressive. Even I can see that. So, I approve.
So there we have it, Alex. A three-step test. Does it move me? Would it move you? And is it impressive anyway? A handy guide for those who like to rate art without getting an arts degree.
Wow! Thanks, corporate man!
But unfortunately, we are still unclear of the definition of fine art.
Okay, I'm getting really sick of conversations and arguments over the question, what is art? You know what? I'm going to answer it right now. Fine art is a subjective term used to identify the object, action, or concept surrounded by signs showing how to interpret the object, action, or concept. Moving on! Let's meet the six artists chosen by the god of contemporary art. This is Suki, a video artist showcasing nature. This is Samal, a sculptor inspired by science, technology, and engineering. This is Saad, a multimedia artist who reflects his culture. Meet Ben, an abstract painter. This is Matt, a sculptor of installations all painstakingly handmade. And this is Eugenie Scrase, who,
Will you talk us through what you're showing us here? And what is it?
What is it? It's bits and bobs from these stands. I went to Stockholm a few weeks back, and I saw these defensive stands for roadworks, and I really liked how they were sort of containing spaces and things, and so I used to steal things like that and use them, but instead I felt like I needed to make them myself, so I had a go at welding, spot welding for the first time.
You know what? I've got an uneasy feeling she's going to win. Never mind that. Let's hear what they're doing for their first assignment.
Welcome to Hastings. We're here because Hastings is by the sea. Now, obviously, there's a long tradition of artists making work that is inspired by the British coastline. And so this is your chance to make a work that carries on that tradition.
The artists have been commissioned to create art for three locations on the Hastings seafront. And in a fortnight, Saatchi will assess their work. Two artists will collaborate at each site, forcing them to combine ideas and skills.
Warning, warning, ego clash, turn away now. Sorry, I didn't mean to get like that. It's just that no matter how much two people may seem to get along at the time, if they're a pair of creatives, there's going to be more tension than a family Christmas party. Something is going to happen. Even if you take an artist, clone them several times, they're going to fight. You know, it's like the time I cloned myself several times and used myself for a barbershop quartet.
We were sailing alone down the Moonlight Bay. We could hear the voices singing. They seemed to say, "You have stolen her heart. Now don't go away." As we sang love's old sweet song on Moonlight Bay. On Moonlight Bay.
I hate you all.
Anyway, let's see what's going on. Suki and Samal were inspired by a reflector and created a large version of one, plus one that spins around, creating an electrical current.
The original design proved far too ambitious and has been simplified. It now no longer has a dynamo, telephone, or radio transmitter attached.
Just give it a rotation.
But it does at least, with a helping hand, spin round.
Wow, it's amazing.
Saad and Ben are inspired behind the history of architecture around the place and have created a ghost hut made from scaffolding.
But we can't have that pipe sticking out of there, you see?
What's that then?
That? Yeah.
Can't be much about that unless you just do that.
Why can't we do that? I never really thought about the bulges that sort of come out when the netting sort of goes over them. And that just looks really untidy and it's not what I wanted.
And Eugene Matt made a pretend zoo with a fake rock and a fake cage.
I don't think we've got it right.
It's so badly made. And it doesn't look like a rock, so it doesn't intrigue anyone.
All of them are potential disasters. All of them are because... And the disaster is boringness. And no real... nothing is really better than the emptiness that was in that space before an artist came along. And that's always the problem with public art. It's always the problem with installation art and conceptual art. That the nonsense that goes on in the heads of those poor students whose minds have been corrupted by decades of garbage that goes on in art schools is going to be manifested there out in the street for the public to see.
Okay, there are a few problems here. First of all, I have to say that there are three different types of judges in this particular art exhibition. First, the art critics, including Charles Saatchi, the public, and then the viewer. I say this because seeing through identifiable signifiers makes an object or concept art. So when the signs are changed, the way we see the artwork may be very different, or not identifiable as artwork at all. So when we see Eugenius and Matt's rock abstract cage, we see the object get made in an unprofessional way, struggle out the door, and doubt their own work. Not to mention, each time we see this, we hear this goofy music.
It was really tough because you had to do it in segments and make it fit through the doorway.
When the public sees this, they have a... What was it, Matthew?
Not necessarily any sympathy or tolerance for conceptual art.
But when the critics see it, it's with an expectation of contemporary art. And even get in paddling swans to create not only new views and perspectives, but also because they're having an active involvement. The artwork becomes interactive, stimulating the aesthetic to greater extent. Which brings me to my second problem. Despite Saatchi commissioning public artwork from the six artists as a form of trial, the artwork Saatchi and the panel of judges like the most is actually the one that the public like the least. What was the point of that? To screw with the public's mind? Honestly, if I was to see these artworks up close, I'd like them. The reflector is an unworldly shape that has a great physical presence. The two boathouses show a history that I don't really need to know in order to enjoy the aesthetic quality of it. And the invisible zoo, well, actually, I don't really like that. But then again, I haven't been on a swan. But seeing all this through a hideous semi-reality television show, I judge these works harshly. I look down upon these young students who put a lot of effort into their work. This is why I hate reality TV shows like The X Factor. Who am I to judge? It really should be called something like Tate Idol. I can't believe this. I'm watching an art television show, and I'm feeling dumber. That shouldn't happen! I feel like I should be doing something more constructive and intelligent, like juxtaposing the Doctor Who theme song with the introduction towards Superman Returns.
We'll be right back.
let's see what these guys have to do now. Hopefully it's going to be in a place where modern art is understood and respected. A place with a contemporary mindset and...
And next, they must create artwork to sit alongside the old masters at one of Britain's finest stately homes.
What, you're looking for trouble now?
Welcome to Sudley Castle. This is where we want you to do your next big project.
Charles Saatchi believes that really good art should engage with the past and reinvent classic traditions. And he wants you to have the opportunity to show that contemporary art does have a relationship with the past and that you can bring together the old and the new in a really exciting and innovative way.
Three generations of the Dent Brocklehursts still live in the castle, including Lady Ashcombe and her daughter, Molly. It's Molly who has continued the family's patronage of the arts by organising contemporary art exhibitions in the gardens.
It's not just a stately home, there's some people living here. They may not notice the presence of their real-life commissioners at all, but I think they'd be wise if they did notice it and try and think about it and try and empathise with the people who've commissioned the work from them.
Oh, I'm sorry. Continue.
Thank you for coming here. We're going to have a look at three different rooms. And I'd like you to find an object in one of the rooms that inspires you to create a new work of art. In 2 weeks' time, you're going to come back and replace the work that you've selected with the work that you've created.
You'll need to decide which object or artwork in the room you are going to replace. But whatever you create must be a contemporary take on the replaced thing.
Sounds good.
Two artists will be working together in each room. And although they'll be creating independent pieces, they'll need to ensure their artwork complements one another. Self-taught painter Ben Lowe has chosen to replace a piece of art from the bedroom.
As soon as I found out that we were going to be creating artwork for the rooms, I was immediately looking at the pictures and the photos that were in those rooms and whether they could inspire a painting of my own.
Yeah, could work.
Sam Zealey chooses the chapel.
But I quite like the sense of having sort of a connection through your body, but not actually sort of you physically making a sound, so your body is making a sound.
Interesting.
19-year-old Eugenie Scrase, who creates sculptures from found objects, has also chosen the bedroom.
I really like that. I'll have to take a photo of that. That's amazing.
I'm sorry, what are you looking at?
She's ignoring all the artwork and is fascinated by the electrical cabling.
Anyway, to fast forward a bit here, Matt has created a giant glass Christmas bauble filled with wine jelly to hang in the church. Nothing dangerous about that, so let's move on. Suki has decided to replace the library contents with a mirror and black books.
You like art?
Oh, yes, yes, especially late art. Yes, yeah. I mean, the way he's captured the look, the cow's looking over there, we can't see what the cow's seeing, maybe the artist's saying cows know something we don't.
Saab has decided to create a few towers of japatis in the middle of the library. Oh, and mailing it to the owner.
Do you have any sort of plan what the arrangement or the presentation of this black might be?
Well, I think we're seeing it here, and I'm saying that it's going to be in the far end of the room, so I don't know what more.
I just think that that's very naughty of you to go ahead with an idea without informing me.
Can I try taking that carpet out?
No.
And she clearly has not left any space for negotiation at all. She's 200% going ahead with her ideas. It's really not on. And I can't believe that an artist with her intelligence and with her integrity could actually not think about the impact her black fucking books would have on my work. I've never been so angry before. And look, this looks really bad on me because my work talks about loving and sharing in this repository that I've made over the last week. And where the fuck is it all now, you know? She just drained it all out of me.
Sam has created a large sacrificial copper plate electronic sound sculpture.
With you actually kind of interacting with the piece, you make the circuit, you make the connection.
Okay.
And then it actually, it becomes...
I know exactly what you meant, because it's basically it's the same as you get from a guitar lead.
Yeah, definitely.
You take the guitar lead out and you touch it. It's very annoying.
Yeah.
Ben replaces this painting with this painting, and then this painting. All right. And Eugenius has,
I've had a bit of a change of heart. I decided I've always liked the potential in movement, but never the actual movement. And so I was actually thinking that I might keep it static. It's even more powerful when it's not working. They'll imagine it go around. So there's, you know, there's a bit of effort coming from the viewer's point of view. It makes them think a bit more about things.
You know, listening to her is like watching the movie I'm Not There. You don't enjoy it because the pace, semiotics, chronological timeline, and concepts are not how a movie should be, so you start looking at it like a piece of art, and all of a sudden, I can't judge it. In the same way, you can't prove that God doesn't exist without faith, for without faith he is nothing, and would promptly vanish in a puff of logic. See what I'm saying? She uses a form of argument that causes her to be right without any need for further discussion. Do you know how dangerous that is? It means she's going to win! Bah! So the final task is just to woo the man himself. No theme, no project, just a gallery. I'm tired of all this, so let's just fast forward all of this, shall we?
It ultimately has to go on the basis of the most outstanding work in this exhibition. The work that he would like to show at the Hermitage is your work, Eugenie.
Fucking hell. No. I get to go to St. Petersburg.
So Charles has chosen you, Eugenie.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, what a bloody surprise. She won over Saatchi with this. A found object, which is a log grown into a fence. Yep, a whole series of her coming up with crap and then... this wins over the god of contemporary art.
And it pains me to say it, but I actually really like it.
But that's not what makes me angry. No, 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 no. I might have been harsh earlier, but the fact is, I like these artists. No, really, I do. Jokes aside. I like the aesthetics, the identity, the innovation, and the absurdity. Plus, the people seem to be like the most lovely folks on the planet. But while these folks are innovative, constructive, and seem to have acquired a good amount of publicity, they deserve better than this show. You see, I'm annoyed at the show itself. The program seemed to imply that we're looking at this new generation of young artists, the voice of the post-millennium, to showcase... what was it again?
The potential for change.
Change, right, of course. What we got was young British artists who were creating parallels with the young British artists of 20 years ago. Rule Britannia. You see, this is what Mathew Collings warned us about when he said that we were drowning in postmodernism and we find it difficult to know what we are doing and where we are. Mind you, this was a show dedicated to fine artists that Charles Saatchi would find appealing. But if I was to be asked to create a show to find the new generations of artists, I would be very happy to show Gillian Beaver, Phil Henson, Banksy, Alistair McIntyre, you know, to encourage...
the potential for change.
Yeah, that's it. Change. And to inject a little optimism into the world. But no, what we're given is... this show, which is insulting to the artists by making them look that they've opened their mind up so much that their brains are falling out their ears, insulting to the art market because it creates nothing different or permanent, and it's insulting to the viewer because they think they're watching arrogant, pretentious, postmodern crap. Oh, and As one final insult, one of my favourite songs is being played, Sweet Dreams. Now, this is indeed the worst footage to be played with the Eurythmics. I'm sorry, I know this is merely a personal whine, but after being in such a bad mood, I have to end on a high, so excuse me.
Today's episode of The Pretentious Show has been brought to you by the Cloned Crotchets and their new album, Take Me Down to the Pub, It's Friday and I Need a Drink.
Take me down
to the pub, it's Friday
and I need a drink.